This week, YouTube was at the center of a controversy that shined a light on the company's challenges in watching over a massive library of user-generated video that grows by the second. Some advertisers fled the site after predatory comments were flagged on videos of children. YouTube responded by eliminating comments altogether on most content featuring minors. YouTube launched in 2005, and it soon caught the eye of a Google executive named Susan Wojcicki. Google bought YouTube a year later for $1.65 billion. Last year, with Wojcicki as CEO, YouTube was valued at $160 billion. Wojcicki, a 50-year-old mother of five and daughter of a Polish immigrant, is a titan of Silicon Valley. Forbes lists her as the seventh most powerful woman in the world. Susan and I got together at YouTube's headquarters outside San Francisco for a Sunday sit-down.
All right, so here we are, one of the elephants.
It may not look like much, but that is a piece of internet history. It's the first video ever uploaded to YouTube. Today, 500 hours of video are uploaded to the site every minute, and 2 billion users log in every month.
I could see that this was a very different kind of content than what we have on TV, but that people wanted to see it, and that we could have our own version of hits.
In other words, Charlie gets his finger bit, and the entire world has seen it.
People didn't see at first that this was something that was going to be big.
Susan Wojcicki has an early eye for companies that will change the world. In 1998, she rented out the garage of her Menlo Park, California home to a couple of guys named Sergey and Larry, who were working on a little startup called Google.
I wish I could say, oh, I saw them. They were so brilliant. But no, I just wanted to cover the mortgage.
That's all it was.
Initially, that's right. All it was. But then I began to use their product. And there was actually a moment where I was at work, and it was so early in Google's life. And so the service went down. And I thought, wow, I can't do my work because it's become so essential to me.
Right.
And it was in that moment where the light bulb went off. I thought, this is going to be important, and I really want to work here.
Wojcicki left a good job at Intel to become employee number 16 at Google.
Well, four people joined the day before me. So I just want to tell you that if I had joined one day earlier, I would have been even earlier.
In 2006, Wojcicki convinced Google that the company should acquire YouTube.
There were a lot of people that really questioned the acquisition. Yeah. I remember there was even a headline that said, only a moron would buy YouTube.
not that you're keeping track or anything.
No, yeah. Not that we're keeping track, exactly.
YouTube grew along with the careers of creators who had found a new platform to spread their work. From the Lonely Island guys to Justin Bieber.
I'm your child to the whole wide world.
And K-pop sensation Psy.
Open Gangnam Style.
Whose Gangnam Style video was the first ever with 1 billion views. But YouTube also has created a new kind of celebrity, as famous and as wealthy as rock stars.
Let's open it!
Ryan, who does the toy reviews, who made $22 million last year at 7 years old. Does that stuff blow your mind that your platform has allowed a seven-year-old playing with toys to make $22 million?
It's amazing to me whenever I hear the stories of creators, people who did hair, they did makeup, they did woodworking, and then they were actually able to turn it into a career and were constantly growing. So the number of creators, for example, who are earning six-figure incomes from YouTube actually grew 40% year on year last year.
Homegrown niche YouTube communities have started major trends in beauty.
The power of makeup.
Launched the near billion-dollar market of watching other people play video games.
No! Yes!
And then there's the slime.
We have probably moved the glue market as a result of all the slime videos.
But YouTube is not just entertainment.
All of a sudden, oh, the Arab Spring is playing out on YouTube, where presidential debates are taking place on YouTube. Was that a concerted thing for you guys to think about, let's elevate this?
YouTube is known for initially the cat videos, but then we started seeing, wow, this is a platform that can have these far-reaching implications. So right now we're very focused on the responsibility that comes with that.
It's a big responsibility for a massive global platform that relies on billions of everyday users. Since the time of our interview, companies including Disney, AT&T, and Hasbro pulled their ads from YouTube after a user pointed out a pattern of predatory comments on videos of children.
I'm making this video with only one intention, and that is to bring awareness to this.
YouTube responded, saying, "We took immediate action by deleting accounts and channels and reporting illegal activity to authorities." The company announcing on Thursday it will disable all comments on videos featuring young children. The issue of policing content that grows exponentially by the day remains YouTube's greatest challenge.
We committed to having 10,000 people focused on controversial content by the end of last year. But we also use machines along with the people.
How do you guys decide? And how does a machine decide what should and should not be on YouTube?
We release and we say these are community guidelines, but we're constantly refining them, and that's because the world is changing. And so when we make changes to our policies, we usually consult with experts, whether they are experts in child safety, experts in law enforcement, like understanding where's the best place to draw the line.
With the recent spread of fake news and conspiracy theories online, YouTube also is working to contain misleading content. The company announced in January its algorithm no longer will recommend conspiracy videos.
There is the question of what kids see when they go looking for things for school. If my kid wants to research 9/11, for example, they might see some stuff that comes in underneath that I don't want them to see. Conspiracy videos and things like that. Have you guys addressed that?
We have a YouTube Kids app. We are very careful about the content that's in there. We also enable a number of tools for parents, like the ability to turn off search or to limit which videos they're seeing. But if you look at our main app, we want to make sure that we're delivering the right information to people. When there's breaking news, we look to use authoritative sources. With common internet conspiracies, what we'll do is we'll link to and put in the video information that comes from Wikipedia or Encyclopedia Britannica so that users can get context for the video that they're watching.
It's critical that we're on the right side of history.
Wojcicki ranks among Silicon Valley's most powerful women, but she's near the top of a list that still is far too short.
But what else can we do as a society to get more women in this field?
When we did research at Google on this, the women who were successful are in tech now. Someone in their life encouraged them. And tech needs more women. We'll have better innovation, we'll have better products, and it will be better for society in the long term.
As I mentioned, Wojcicki has 5 children and tries to make it home for dinner every night. YouTube, by the way, gives 22 weeks of maternity leave to mothers like her. To hear Susan talk about the wild range of skills you can learn on YouTube and the one that surprised her the most, check out our web extras at today.com/Sunday. And don't forget to subscribe to the Sunday Sit Down podcast to hear the entire unedited interview with Susan Wojcicki. You can find it on Apple Podcasts or wherever you get yours.